Welcome to part two on our series on nutrition tools. This section is covering establishing recommended intake levels. What most people think about our nutrient intake levels, when I say nutrients, I'm talking about vitamins or minerals, is that there is a safe range that's pretty large and then a really small danger zone. But the reality is that it's actually just a small safety range, and our DRIs, or our recommended dietary allowances, are generally put in this small area right here where the arrow is. Now out here, this is marginal, and it really depends from person to person, depends on the individual. And then there's a danger of toxicity with too much of one nutrient and a danger of deficiency with too little of another nutrient. The question is, how are these guidelines established? How does the committee, the Dietary Reference Intake Committee, establish guidelines for our recommended daily allowances? How much of a vitamin or mineral that we need to take to make sure that we are in this safety range? I want to apologize for this moving a little bit, but this is my example on how, for example, a calcium requirement, our calcium needs are determined. What I'm showing you here is that once research is done, all the data is plotted. And you can think of each of these little boxes here as maybe 1,000 or even 10,000 people. In this instance, they might all have a level need of 700 milligrams a day for calcium. And over here, this group of people might have 900, with this group of people a little over 600 milligrams. So that's what they would need per day. But the thousands and thousands of people who have been studied, their information is then plotted on the graph. And right there, what I'm circling is this whole group would need 700 milligrams of calcium. Once the data is plotted, it always is in the shape of a bell curve. And there are some people who need very little, 400 milligrams of calcium. Some people are going to need 1,100, 1,200, or even more calcium per day. But the average will probably be around 750. And again, I'm just using this as an example. So this is the average amount based on the data, based on the research that's done. This is called the EAR, or the average, the estimated average requirement for a population. So again, EAR. Now we don't want to set the recommendation at the average. Now why would you think that? Why don't you want to set the recommendation of the average intake? Well, you're going to be missing a huge portion of people. Everyone who needs more than that 750 or 800 milligrams is not going to get enough. What about the person who needs 1,100? So the RDA is set at 98%, and that means 98% of the population is going to be covered with that recommendation. All of those people are going to be covered. So that's the RDA at 98%. Now, why not put it out even further? And if we look out even further, we could say, well, why not cover the entire population? And if we put it out way over here, maybe at 1,200, 1,400, 1,800, then we would cover everybody, right? Well, what's the problem with that? What about this person who needs 400? Do they really need to get, would it be appropriate to recommend that they have 3, 4, or 5 times their need? So the way the Dietary Reference Intake Committee establishes these guidelines is, first, research is done. The committee then analyzes the data. They establish the average, and then based on this graph or this curve, then put the value at 98%. So there are a few outliers who won't be covered, but the rest of the population will, without getting into a toxicity range or a toxicity level. Okay, so let's review. This goes back to what we were talking about previously, but when the committee sets their goals, one, they're looking at a group of data and how much of each nutrient that an individual might need. And then they look at the foods that will supply those nutrients. And again, this is macro and micronutrients. The RDAs are only going to be for our micronutrients or vitamins and minerals. Remember, we had the AMDR, our acceptable macronutrient density range, for our macronutrients. But again, what foods are going to correspond with that? Well, what they found out by analyzing all the data is that Americans need more whole grains. So here's the goal, way out here, getting 15%. Now, I keep talking, some people don't eat a lot of grains, and that's okay, but the problem is not the whole grains, it's replacing the whole grains with refined grains. Look at this, 200% of what would be the limit. Now, really, you don't need to eat any refined grains. There's no reason to eat refined grains. It's easy and convenient. They might taste good, but there's no reason health-wise. So all these refined grains really should be replaced with whole grains. Vegetables at 59% of our goal. And I have to point out the only reason Americans are at 59% of the goal, which is actually horrible, but the only reason it looks actually pretty good compared to some of these other ranges, and that's because of French fries. Because the most popular vegetable is a potato, and the most commonly, the way we eat potatoes most commonly is by eating French fries. Fruits at 42% of the goal. Milk products, milk and milk products. Remember, most milk products are processed; they're not necessarily good for you. 52%. Then we can go down the line here. Fiber at 40%, and then some of our important nutrients. Not getting enough potassium. Definitely not enough vitamin D. And calcium. So what do you need to limit? Solid fats and added sugars. Now, there are some solid fats that are okay. We will talk about this in the lipid chapter. But added sugars, it should be less than 5% of your diet. Limiting added sugars, that is any table sugar, corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup, honey, most honey is highly refined, maple syrups, anything in this range is added. Fruit juice sweeteners, those are all added sugar, and they really need to be limited. Refined grains, remember this is a lot of bread products, are refined grains, and crackers, and cereals, and pastas. So, and then, of course, you're going to get grain products in your dessert items as well. Sodium, most Americans are at 150%, and then saturated fat at about 110%. Again, we'll cover which types of saturated fat are healthier for you and which ones are not. Healthy for you when we get to the lipid chapter. So I'm just going to show you a short little summary video now.